Very good afternoon. So today we'll be seeing some questions and problems in the chapters which we've finished already. So first I would like to start with your genetics overall as such. So I just brought in few problems and few questions for you. Okay, so I'll just read out the question and then I'll explain you the answer. Okay, the first question is that capital R small r capital Y small y. Okay, so from this this parental type, how many gametes can it yield? And the options are 4, 5, 2, 6. Okay, so I told you already, if I have to calculate the number of gametes which this can yield, I have to first count the number of heterozygotes. So here this is a heterozygote, this is a heterozygote, so I have two heterozygotes, correct? So in this, the formula is 2 power n, and your n is nothing but the number of heterozygotes. So it is 2 power 2, that is equal to 4. So from this, how many gametes I can get? I can get totally 4 gametes. The answer is 4. Okay. Okay, next is a gamete contains only one allele of a gene, 2 alleles, 3 alleles, and none of these. So what the question is, the gamete contains only one allele, 2 alleles, 3 alleles, and none of these. The answer is, the gamete contains only one allele of a gene. Okay, so you all know that the gametes are haploids, correct? So when two haploid gametes are coming together only, the diploid zygote is formed. So the gamete will contain only one allele. There will be one more allele in this in the other gamete. When they fertilize, that will end up in 2N. Okay, next. On what cellular structures are the genes in eukaryotes carried? So genes are carried out in what cellular structures? So what do you mean by cellular structures? Is your cell organelles. Okay, so I repeat, on what cellular structures are the genes in eukaryotes carried? And the options are endoplasmic reticulum, nuclear membrane, chromosomes, and mitochondria. So the answer is chromosomes. So your genes are carried in chromosomes. Okay, in man, the chromosome number is 46. Okay, how many chromosomes are present in man's muscle cells? Okay, I repeat, in man, the chromosome number is 46. How many chromosomes are present in man's muscle cell? So if I say the chromosome number is 46, correct? So all your body cells, okay, all your body cells, that is, your muscle cell is also a body cell, will have the same set of chromosome. But the gametes are haploid. So they'll have 46 by 2, that is nothing but your 23 chromosomes. So muscle cell is a question. So muscle cells will also have 46 chromosomes. Okay, the next question is, number of chromosome in human male is 23. 23 pairs, 22 pairs plus XY and 22 pairs. Okay, so I repeat, number of chromosomes in a human male is, okay, 23 pairs, 22 pairs plus XY, and then 22 pairs. So if you see this, okay, both option B and C are correct. See, we normally say 23 pairs, correct? So 23 in adults, 46, that is nothing but 23 pairs. But here they have specified, you have 23 pairs in an option, and also you have 22 pairs plus XY. So you have to choose the, so both are almost right. Okay, but this is the most appropriate option. So in each, you will get these type of questions. You might, it might appear as if more than one options are right. So that case you have to be little analytical. Okay, yes, 23 pairs is correct and 22 pairs plus XY is correct, but which is more appropriate you have to choose. Okay, you cannot say from the answers you've chosen all three options are wrong. No, you have to choose the most appropriate one. There might be more than one right answers also. So that is where biology is challenging. If you see physics and all, for the problem you'll get only one answer, but here more than one answers will be right, but you should know which is the most appropriate one. Okay, the question will look easy, but the options will be confusing. Okay, the next question is, okay, now here is your genetic problem. Okay, a deceased man. So you're supposed to draw pedigree as when you come across these kind of questions. Okay, a deceased man. Deceased man marries a normal woman. They get 3 daughters and 5 sons. Okay, all the daughters were deceased and the sons were normal. The gene of this diseases. Okay, it's not. So fine, let's draw the pedigree. The deceased man. So the person has got the disease. So I'm shading. It's a man, so it is in the square. Okay. He is marrying a normal woman. Okay, so the woman is normal. So I'm just leaving it blank. No shading, nothing. Okay. So they get 3 daughters. They get 3 daughters and 5 sons. Okay, they get 3 daughters. So if I write like this, it means all 5 are not affected. Okay. All the daughters were deceased. So all the daughters are affected. But the sons were not. Okay. So what kind of disorder is this? Sorry. So the how will you find out the type of disorder is that? See, first of all, you have only 4 options. Okay, first is sex-linked recessive, then sex-linked dominant, then autosomal recessive, then autosomal dominant. Okay, so you have to know certain characters which are here, okay, for analyzing. Okay, so if it is a dominant disease, you can see in all the generations, okay, this is first generation, this is second, third. So in all the generation, at least one of the offsprings will be affected. See, as you know, the characteristic feature of a dominant gene, even if it is present in one copy, it causes the disease, correct? So if that kind of disorder is there, you can see that. So you have only 4 options. So as I told you, if it is a dominant disorder, okay. See, you know the definition of dominant genes, right? So though it is in one copy, it affects the person. So if this kind of gene is running in this family, then in each generation, a person will be affected, okay. So somebody or the other will be affected in each generation. So that is the main feature of the dominant disorder, okay. But if it is a recessive disorder, so you all know if it's a recessive gene, it should be present in 2 copies, correct? So recessive character is expressed when it is present in 2 copies. So recessive, if it is a recessive kind of inheritance, it will skip the generations. If it is a dominant inheritance, in all the generation, at least one person will be affected. Okay, so that is the main thing. Okay, now to figure out if it is sex-linked or autosomal. Okay, now. If it is autosomal, okay, if it is autosomal, you can see that there is no discrimination between men and women. Okay, all are equally affected because both male and female have equal set of autosomal genes, correct? So there is no discrimination, okay, only males are affected, nothing like that because both men and women have 22 pairs of autosomes, okay. But if it is a sex-linked disease, okay, then more, if it is sex-linked dominant, more females are affected, more females are affected because female has 2 X chromosomes, correct? So if it is a dominant disease, if any of their X is affected, then the female is affected. So more females are affected in a sex-linked dominant. And in sex-linked recessive disorder, more males are affected. Why? Because this is a recessive disorder, correct? So males have only 1 X chromosome, correct? They have only 1 X chromosome and 1 Y chromosome. But females have 2 X chromosomes. So if it is a recessive disorder for male, okay, if this gene is affected, they're affected, that's it. But in the same condition, in female, if this gene is affected, this female is not affected. Why? Because there is one more X chromosome to protect the female from the effect of the recessive gene. So that is why in sex-linked recessive, more males are affected. Whereas in sex-linked dominant, more females are affected.